Dear tea friends from around the world, hello and welcome to a new Chashi lesson. Today I'm going to talk about Gushupur, and this time about new, fresh Gushupur. The question is, well, why? First, the assumption is, wow, aged pur, that's where the best pur are, that's where the action is, where the auctions have the highest prices, millions really for a cake. And why should we get interested in young pur, fresh pur? Well, first, it's much more affordable, and second, actually, the reason is linked to this auction pur and this aged pur. And the link is that what makes these pours from the past, these from the Hao era to the before 1940 to the Hongyin, Luyin in the early communist era in the 50s, 60s, what makes these pours so special is that they were made almost exclusively of wild Gushu pour. Gushu in Chinese means old tree. To be called old tree, it should be at least 100 year old. But in Qing Dynasty, there were some already very old plantations. So sometimes all these Gushu are not necessarily wild, but technically, actually, they almost are, because they were growing by themselves, not really tended, managed by men in the late Qing, early Republic, and also during the beginning of the communist era, there was not such a big market for such pur, so the old trees were enough to supply enough leaves, and they did not really need to plant a lot of new trees in plantations like is nowadays the case. And so once people realized, wow, actually these collectibles, these really famous and very good tasting pours, in the past they were made exclusively of Gushu pur. They think, oh, why not get interested in recent Gushu pur, because that's the most important factor in the quality of a tea is always the leaf material. The quality of the leaf is what makes a tea good or bad, and this is especially the case for teas that don't necessitate so much process. Now, oolong is the tea that is the most processed. White tea probably is the one that is the least processed because it's simply dried. And the pu'er is still quite a simple process, dried under the sun and then steamed and pressed. Or if it's in loose shape, it does not even need to be pressed. So actually it's quite a simple process, where the major point about the quality is the quality of the place where it grew. And old trees have deep roots, so they can extract the water and the nutrients from deep in the soil, and this makes the nutrients more pure, and because of all this, they've become very, very popular. And we can also see different stages in popularity. Now, there was Taiwan had a golden age for such pu'ers after the return of Hong Kong to China, and before China became really very rich. So that's between 1997 and let's say 2005, 2006 maybe. That's also when you can see that China starts to import a lot of wine, which means they become more affluent, and they start to enjoy life. And except wine, tea is also one of the things that Chinese have started to enjoy more and more as they become more rich in the last 15 years. And so in that, I was lucky to have participated a little bit at that time. That's basically where I started to blog and to learn about tea. So in 2003, I was able to get a very nice pressed Yiwu cake, 500 grams. The wrapper was white, so that it would be easier to import in Taiwan, because Taiwan and China still had some political conflicts. It was not so easy to import Chinese tea into Taiwan in order not to compete with Taiwanese tea makers. But basically in 2002-2003, there were a lot of other Taiwanese makers who went to Yunnan and they started to make their own branded pours, and they were able to make very high quality pour with the help of Yunnan farmers, because at that time, since 1997, the Taiwanese market was the one that was the most interested in pu'er, and also young pu'er, and willing to spend money on it. And pu'er was still cheaper than oolong, so it made sense for these Taiwanese pu'er makers to go there to press their own cakes. They were very high quality. Now the situation changed around 10-15 years ago, when China became so affluent that and very rich that the purchasing power moved to Beijing and Shanghai. The Chinese themselves started to press their own cakes, and they were able to and were willing also to pay more top dollars for the best materials. And that's also when you see some regions become very famous, like Lao Banzang, Yiwu became more specific with different villages. So since then it's been very difficult to find a very good Gushu material, because it's become more and more expensive, like a 20% price increase every year. I was privileged to still have some access to it, and I start to be thirsty. So I'm looking in my jar. I want to start to make to brew this tea. So let's cut a little bit on the history and start to brew the tea. Let's first have a look at it. So it's my loose leaf pu'er from last spring from Lanzhang. Now this Gushu is roughly, these trees are roughly 300 years old. And I'm going to brew them in a silver teapot. But it starts to be hot. Okay, I've warmed my water already. We have music from Leonardo da Vinci, La Musique Secrète by Douce Mémoire de Denis Raisin d'Ardre, the latest music. It's a very nice book with music exploring the paintings of Leonardo and the music that could go together from that time. And the idea is, I'm pairing it because, old music with teeth from old trees. So that that's a nice, interesting fit. Okay, I'm really starting to feel too hot. Good. I always have handkerchief here. I'm very sorry for this. Oh, Taiwan is humid and hot, and I did not put the air conditioner on, so I'm a bit sweating. I apologize again. It's live. If it were not, I would cut it now. But well, let's have fun. So, you see, I'm not using too many leaves. Russell, ma'am. Because I have a tea friend who's asking this question. He actually found out that he cannot drink this tea after 2 o'clock in the afternoon, because then at 1 o'clock at night he still cannot sleep. So it's a tea that is really very, very strong. Gushu, wild pu'er. So these trees grow very, very tall, have deep, deep roots, and as in Yunnan, basically every places are over 1,000 meters high, so there are always a high mountain. So they get a lot of energy from the soil, from the sun, from the clean air, from the environment, a very clean environment, because they don't grow industrially, but like in forests. So pu'er also by itself is the most concentrated tea, which is why we can keep it almost in contact with air. So it's really the most powerful tea, and then you add the fact that it's already pu'er is the most powerful tea, and then it's gushu pu'er, so it's even more powerful. And then here in this tea, if you look at it more precisely, you will notice these are only new fresh leaves. Very few huangpian. Huangpian are the older leaves, which usually bring a bit more bitterness and less fragrance, but more structure. But if you look at the leaves here, they are mostly young, fresh leaves. Okay. So this tea is a bit special. It's very difficult to find this kind of material grade in like in regular tea stores. Also in the past, remember during the communist era, they would do recipes. They would mix all the leaves together and make their cakes with a mix of different grades of teas from different regions, because they did not really want to create so many different products. But now that the tea business is private, you can find all kinds of variations, people focusing on their own plantation, people doing very precisely which village or which age of tree or the season. You can get a lot of detail nowadays, but still most of the time to have a commercial grade poor, what people will do is still mix the buds and the larger leaves, mix maybe Gushu with plantation in order to cut down the cost. And also if you are a farmer and you want to sell your own tea with your own brand, maybe you have to at the end be able to sell all the leaves that you are producing. So then you also have this incentive to mix and to press different grades together so that the low quality leaves don't taste that bad because they are mixed with a little bit better leaves. There are of course many different strategies that farmers and vendors can use, but only to take the very best is a bit a difficult strategy because it's going to make the price very very high. And so my reasoning is actually I'm using a buying group in Taipei of tea connoisseurs, and since we are a bit far from Yunnan, it's best simply to buy the best and not to to buy other teas at the same time, other leaves. So we just focus on the best for these leaves from Jiangcheng and from Lansang. Now these are Lansang. So the advantage using very few leaves, we did not pay much attention to the time. We'll just see what comes out. And using a silver teapot, it's going to amplify the aromas, especially the smells. Let's see. The color is already a little bit dark, despite the few leaves I've used. Yeah, you can have a look. I'm looking forward to it. This is very hot. Okay, the leaves have opened up well. They take up very little space inside the teapot. Maybe a little bit too difficult to see. So, but really I'm using very, very little tea, and already the color is quite dark because I've let it brew for some time. But again, and then the concentration is a question of personal taste. Some like it strong, some like it a little bit lighter. But what is amazing, by insisting of having only the top material, the smallest leaves from this Gushu from Lansang, is the purity that you get. It's simply amazing how pure it feels. So even though the color is quite dark, so it feels, oh, it should be quite strong, but the first feeling is so light. Light, like there is nothing but sweetness, but then the flowers, they explode in the mouth, but maybe not explode, but they are, well, they think they are present very, very strong and deep. Mm. But gently, it's really excellent. Excellent in terms of purity. So, repeating myself, but so the best way to brew this tea is to use very little leaves. I cannot imagine using twice as much the power, the feeling would be so powerful. I do think that it would it can be unsettling, but like this it feels, I do feel relaxed again and comfortable. The sweetness is in the mouth, it persists very, very long. It has a nice flowery scent. No, it's not. It has not the same sweetness as an oolong. An oolong will have more roundness. Here, the, there's a little bit an underlying, maybe not astringent feeling, but it's you find more wild character to this. But it's very, very bright and sharp almost, and pure again. So, and then that's when you make also the connection with a powerful Haozuji era pu'er that has aged, or Lu'in that has aged, and they also have this purity. Just the sense, the fragrances are completely different for an aged pu'er, but in terms of taste, actually you get something that is quite similar, but here even with more energy, more chi, more strength, and because these are really completely pure, I would say with even more purity than the aged Haozuji or Lu'in. But this increased energy is very strong, and that's why it's very actually very economical, because a couple of grams are enough for a tea session. Are enough to give you this a very pleasant energetic feeling. So here we are drinking it almost a little bit like a green tea, but the advantage is with green tea, your problem is always you have either too little or too much. If it's really very good green tea, you might drink it very quickly, and then when you don't have enough, or the other problem, you buy a bit too much, and then once the year has passed, the green tea that you still have on hand has lost its freshness and is less interesting compared to a newer green tea. However, with a fresh Gushu pu'er, you don't have this problem, because if you have leftovers from the previous year, actually it's aging well, and it will continue to age well, so you don't have this this problem. And you can drink it a little bit like a green tea with for its freshness and lightness, for its energy, rather than for its depths. So with the, for, if you want to go for the depths and for the aftertaste, it's better to use a Zesha teapot. The silver teapot is emphasizes more the fragrances, but and it also emphasizes everything, because it's so, it keeps the heat so well. It conducts the heat much better, so it extracts more aromas. So if there's a defect in the leaf, in the taste, it will come out much stronger with the silver teapot. But if it's good, it's going to also be much, much better thanks to a silver teapot compared to a Gai one, for instance. So interestingly, now I've been drinking, I'm almost finishing this, these four cups, and I notice I'm not sweating as much as I was in the beginning. So this tea did help to cool down, despite being very hot. Now I'm sweating less than I was earlier. So it's possible to even feel a bit more freshness with Gushu Pua. Let's have some more and let me tell you a bit more then. So I'm using a more Celadon seam, and this Chabu has also very nice Celadon beige and blue colors. And I don't know if you remember my jar. Does anybody remember what this jar is made of? What was it before being a jar? I'm looking. No comment. Okay. Now, to have it's also an old material, an old stuff. It's called an Anping jar. Anping being the name, the old name of Tainan, a city in the south of Taiwan that was settled by the Holland army before. They had a fort, and when Koxinga, the general from the late Ming dynasty, came to Taiwan, chased away by the Qing, he was able to take over the fort from the Holland army. One of the first time that the Chinese won against Western nation. So they were a bit shocked. And they won, I think, thanks to this, because this used to be a grenade. They would put the powder in it, light it, and then throw it. And because of the thickness of the porcelain here, not porcelain, it's pottery, but glazed, quite thick, so it's not right, huh? When it exploded, it would harm the people nearby, and this was one of the weapons used by the late Ming army that overtook fort in Anping. Okay, I've brewed now the second time. I was again very slow because these leaves are very powerful, so they contain a lot of polyphenols that don't need so much strength to extract, so I prefer to pour very, very slowly to extract them, not too many at a time, in order to not to have a too strong brew. Okay, let's be a bit faster now. Okay. Now I've obtained a little bit a lighter colored brew. So if you don't want your tea to be too strong, you can brew it a bit shorter also. But still, it's the quantity of leaves that you put in the teapot that will decide ultimately how much tea compounds, how much caffeine you intake. So the fewer leaves you use, the fewer will be your global intake, because it will all come out over several brews. So it makes sense when the tea is so concentrated, so pure, to use fewer leaves, since it's not cut. Like this tea, $15 for 10 gram. So it means for 30 gram, you could buy 500 gram of this Xiaguan Tuocha, 5 Tuocha of 100 gram from 2004 in my store. So this gives you an idea how concentrated, or how very different the quality from these leaves is compared to these. Now these are already 15 years, almost 16 years old now, and this is only 1 year old, but so it's over 10 times more expensive than plantation tea. So it's, since we did not cut the price by mixing it with other leaves, this tea is really as concentrated as it gets in terms of pour, and as pure as it gets. And this is what is interesting. That's why you don't need to buy so much. It's just for you to try, how to be able to try once a very, very pure pour made of only gushu, very high small buds, small leaves. Yeah, also very nice. Now this is more a bit on the lighter side. It's easier to drink. It tastes a bit more like more in character like a green, playing more on the on the lighter side, on having a little bit more water to drink, like a Ming Dynasty green tea. But still, thanks to the silver, getting enough aromas out to make the tea interesting, with aftertaste and light perfumed flowers, maybe jasmine. Okay. Well, so the major interest in now in pour for these leaves is the relationship to the very precious 1920s, 30s, Haozuji era poors, also from the Luin in the 50s, 60s. This is basically the same material, so it's a material that we know will age very well. And you can already enjoy it now, very fresh. But when it's so fresh, it's so full of energy that very few leaves are enough. It can then be drank like a green tea almost. The silver amplifies the good and the bad, and here I definitely can see it's only good things that are in these leaves. What else? And to make it a bit more a connection with the past, I've used this jar that was made in the mid 17th century. So also over 300 years, a bit by the time or a bit before these trees in Nansang were planted, and even older is this music from the Leonardo da Vinci era that accompanies me. So, and all this, what is interesting also is that these old trees, old music, old wares, we are able to use them today in the present, adding again some depth and some meaning to our life, to have this link between the past and the present. And this definitely gives us a lot of sweetness, a lot of pleasure. I hope that this will also inspire you to have some pleasure. As again, the idea of these chashi lessons is to make you feel happy at home, enjoy tea as much as you can, so that your time locked down becomes the most happy time in your life. Cheers.